Easter has gone and has come and gone. Easter Sunday was last Sunday, so there's no need to really talk about Easter anymore. But the reality is, this is the start of Easter. This is the start of Easter season. On last Sunday was the start of what is called Easter tide, which lasts until Pentecost Sunday, 50 days after Easter Sunday. So Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, is actually the beginning of the Easter season. And to be literal, if you just need to know it, actually today is Easter in the Orthodox Church. And so, actually it is still Easter. Amen. The resurrection begun a period of examination for the disciples, and even for all those who had come in contact with Jesus. It was the incubation period for the early church. It was the start of the early church. And this seven-week period, this seven-week journey, it lasts 50 days to be exact, and it precedes Pentecost, the foundation or the beginnings of the church as we know it today. The advent of the Holy Spirit is found in the book of Acts, and it happened during Pentecost. And so the Easter season moves us into this Pentecostal moment. During that 50-day period, Jesus fellowshiped with his disciples. He fellowshiped with his disciples depending on what gospel you read. He fellowshiped for 40 days, and some gospels he's ascended on to God. But he fellowshiped with his disciples with doing this 50-day period or 40 days, and the last 10 days, the disciples fellowshiped amongst themselves. We are still in the Easter season. Now that doesn't mean, though, you have to come and go out and buy new clothes for that every Sunday during this Easter season. You don't have to have seven outfits to wear during this season, but you should come to church every Sunday just a little bit brand new. There's something new about your spirit, about your soul. You should be looking like a new person. People should not be able to recognize you for the way you used to be. You should be brand new just a little bit each and every Sunday during this period. Today we start a new sermon series. Called Easter Mixtape. Easter Mixtape. I know somebody's saying, Reverend Robinson, boy, you just come up with that. And somebody is looking at me like, I have no idea what a mixtape is. I don't know what a mixtape is. What are you talking about, Reverend Robinson? A mixtape. And someone is wondering, what is this thing called a mixtape? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let me explain. See, I'm a child of the 70s, and I know my children of the 80s know what a mixtape is. I know you know what a mixtape is. As I became of age, mixtapes came on the scene. See, mixtapes, in a sense, or cassette tapes, replaced 8-track tapes. Hey, somebody don't even know what an 8-track is anymore. But this little cassette tape, it was a little bit more convenient. Now cassette tape came out in the 1960s, but the quality wasn't good. It was good enough to talk on, but it wasn't good enough to hear music on. But by the 70s, the late 70s, early 80s, the technology had improved such that you could put music on cassette tapes. And with the advent of the Walkman, and some of y'all still got a Walkman, and you listen to your music while you were cleaning up. You don't want to get rid of your cassette tape. And your grandkids are like, baby, mama, I'll put it on some CDs for you. You don't know, baby. Okay. I ain't talking about nobody up in here. But Walkman and cassette decks in your car, it changed the game. It made the mixtape real. See, because what happened is, with an 8-track, all you could do is skip through songs. You know, push the button and jump on. Okay, but with a cassette tape, you could record. Oh, well, that changed the game now. You could sit by the air by the speaker. Hey.
Not staying in the same place. It's about us
bouncing back. It's about us bouncing back, allowing the inner divinity inside of us to project and the world to be impacted by us, and we to impact our surroundings. It is about rebounding from losses and allowing the inner divinity within us to help us bounce back and impact the world around us. I ask the Holy Spirit, what should I play? What record should I find? And the Holy Spirit mentioned Big Sean. I said, oh, Holy Spirit. Big Sean? That's not Big Sean, Holy Spirit. Somebody's like, who is Big Sean? But as I flip through the albums of my mind, of my imagination, as I flip through, I stop on the album. I decided, help me, Holy Ghost. Somebody know about Big Sean. I stop on the album, and then as I stop on that album, I watched it and I looked at it, and the first thing that stood out is this song. It called "Move." You know, y'all probably don't know, but you don't listen to that song. I gotta move. Oh, okay. I got moves. I'll make you move. Sorry, help me. You know what I'm talking about. I said, that sounds good because the Easter story is about making moves. I said, yeah, that'll work. But then the Holy Spirit said, no. That's not the track I want you to play. That's not the track I want you to add. And I kept flipping. And then the lyrics hit me. And a song flipped up. And it was a song, blessings. And I feel blessed. You know the song. You know the song. I feel blessed. Way blessed. You know what I'm talking about. I feel blessed. That's not the one. I said, okay, now, all right. I kept on flipping, and I came to the song Bigger Than Me. And I heard Bigger Than Me when the whole town was on their feet, and they all just waiting on you to speak. That's when I realized that this is what? Bigger Than Me. That's when I realized that this is bigger than me. And the Holy Spirit said, no, keep on flipping. This is not the song. And then I saw Bounce Back. Bounce Back. And the lyrics said, last night I took an L. But tonight, I bounce back. And I said, you know what? That sounds like that preach. Help me, Holy Ghost. You know, the Easter story is about Jesus bouncing back. Okay. Be patient with me. I'm going to try to bring it together for you. The Easter season is about bouncing back from the tomb, about bouncing back from losing situations. So, can I tag this text? Bounce back. Amen. Can I tag this text? Bounce back. In the text, Mary is alone as she travels to the tomb. And she realizes that the stone has been rolled away. Now the other text, if you go to the other gospel, Mary goes with other people to the tomb, but in the Gospel of John, she goes by herself and she realizes the stone has been rolled away. She returns to Peter and John and tells Peter and John that the stone has been removed. Peter and John hop up and start running toward the tomb, and it says that John was faster than Peter because he got to the tomb first. He outran Peter, and so here it is. They ran to the tomb and witnessed an empty tomb. The story in John is different from the other gospels, but the end result is still the same. The tomb was empty. It's different. There are more people at the tomb, but the story is different. And it is different, but the story remains the same, that the tomb is empty. Mary is standing near
weeping. Here it is. And Mary is standing there weeping, and John and Peter, they leave and go back home. That's what the text say. And here it is. Mary is standing weeping near the tomb, and she looks into the tomb, and she's asked a question by two angels, one at the head and one at the foot. And then she turns around and is met by Jesus and is questioned by Jesus. The crucifixion was about fear. It was about fear. It was about fear. And so here it is. Here it is in the text. The text. Mary is afraid, or she's upset, or she's perplexed, or she's crying. She's crying, and she doesn't quite know what's going on around her. She turns around and she sees Jesus, and she's taken aback. She doesn't even realize that it is Jesus. But when there's crucifixion, there's going to be some weeping, there's going to be some time, there's going to be some hurt, there's going to be fear. Because crucifixion is designed to make you afraid.
Yes.
It is designed to destroy the movement. See, Jesus was crucified because they wanted to destroy the movement that he was engaged in. They wanted to dismantle the people that he was connected to. They wanted to make sure that his movement stopped. They wanted to hurt the hearts of the people and break down the people. See, when they placed Jesus in the tomb, they figured they had stopped the move.
Yeah.
They figured that they had stopped any rebound that could possibly happen.
Yeah.
They figured they could stop anything that could possibly come out of this, because obviously he's dead. He's in a tomb. He's in a dead place. When Jesus was placed in that tomb, they were sure that things would not rebound.
Yes.
See, the thing is, we remain down because we're afraid to rebound. And the text teaches us something. See, when we remain down, or we remain down, the first thing is because we fail to see God in our situation. And verse 14, it's Mary. She turns around and she sees Jesus, but she doesn't realize it's Jesus. Okay, in the midst of your situation,
all right,
Jesus has been standing right next to you.
Amen.
Walking with you every single day.
Yes.
And you fail to see.
Amen.
And when we fail to see Jesus in the midst of our situation, we don't see the Jesus in other people. You know that person that comes to you and tries to speak a word to you, and tries to convict, and tries to remind you that God is with you, that we're looking past Jesus. So Mary, in the midst of her hurt, in the midst of her angst, in the midst of her pain, here it is. She looks past Jesus. She can't see Jesus. We look past Jesus. And when we're down, we wallow in our downness. We feel like the world is coming to an end. We feel like God has left us. But the text tells us that God is right there in the midst of our hurt and our pain. Next, the text tells us we fail to see God in our situation. But next, we don't know the voice of God. We don't know the voice of God because of the noise in the background.
Yeah.
You know all that noise, that verse 15. See, here it is. Jesus speaks to Mary and asks her a specific question. If Deacon Miller called me, he doesn't even have to say his name because I already know his voice. If somebody you've been around for a while calls your name or says something, you know their voice. But the problem is, when life happens to us, all the noise stops us from hearing God talking to us.
Amen.
Too often, we go through this thing where we can't hear what God is saying. We think it's not God because of all the noise in our head. We can't hear because of, see, she couldn't hear That verse 11, because she was too busy crying. Let me pause right here. Now, you know I'm a weeping preacher. You know, I bust out crying in a minute. But too often, we're crying so much, we don't allow God to use us. And it's one thing to cry. You should cry. You should get it out. But at the same time, you got to cry, get it out, and let it go. The disciples would have been listening to what Jesus said. When they went to the tomb, they would have known he had gotten up. But they were so crying, they were so messed up by the noise around them that they couldn't even hear what he was saying. So Mary couldn't hear. And so she failed to see the God in the situation. She couldn't hear the voice of Jesus because of the noise in the background. But also, we want to hold on to the past. Oh, okay, I know. Where are you going, Reverend? You go to that verse 17. That verse 17, the first thing she does when she realizes that it's Jesus, she wants to hug Jesus. She wants to hold on to Jesus. I know. Somebody's like, well, that's the first thing I would have wanted to do. But then Jesus says, hold up. Now, wait. I got somewhere to be. Okay. Wait. See, too many of us, we holding on to folk for who they used to be. All right. Some of us, we holding on to folk, and we not letting them go where they need to be. You know that parent that hold on to that child? Instead of pushing that child out, oh, help me, don't be mad at me, okay. But every once in a while, you gotta let go. So let me go. I'll get some amens. But she wanted to hold on to Jesus. She wanted to hold on to the Jesus that she knew before the tomb. She didn't realize that Jesus was different after the tomb. See, before the tomb, it was the historical Jesus. After the tomb, it was the divine Jesus. Okay. So she wanted to hold on to the Jesus that she knew. That's what keeps us down. We fail to see the God in our situation. We don't hear the voice of God speaking to us. And we want to hold on to the past. We can't move. But as you look at it, as you look at this text, you move through it. Rome had the nation Israel locked in and was holding them down. And Rome wasn't allowing the nation Israel to rebound physically and mentally. And they weren't allowing people to be all that they could be. See, the reality in life is we all gonna fall. But we are all designed to get back up. Wait. The very nature of the human body is to bounce back. Literally, every 7 years, your cells regenerate, so you can bounce back. When you get sick, the first thing the body does is create a plan so you can bounce back. Everything that the human body is designed to bounce back. It's designed to bounce back. But we live in a world that want to keep you tied down. That want to make sure that you don't bounce back. To make sure that you don't. See, the nation Israel was plagued by oppression. And because of that oppression has a funny way of doing things. Oppression puts fear in people. But it makes people think that they can't bounce back. And even those who oppress, they figure that if I allow this person to bounce back, I'm not going to be able to move forward. And so oppression affects both ways. And the nation Israel, they were being oppressed. And so they figured they couldn't bounce back. They figured this man named Jesus could not possibly get back up. See, the problem is, fear is present to control us, to keep us down, to stop us, occurring in communities, police shootings. I said it this morning. People want you to fear the police. Well, I'm a 48-year-old black man. And every time a police car pulls up next to me, my heart beats a little faster. Not because I've done anything wrong. But because of my interaction with police officers. Because I've had some bad interactions with some bad police officers. And so now, when I see police officers, how does a person get shot in their backyard saying they're holding a gun when they have a phone? A police officer who carries a gun on their hip every time they go to work. I said it this morning, that's like a baker thinking a pan is a stove. You cannot handle a gun and not know what a gun looks like. But the system is designed to keep folk in check. It's designed to make sure that there's fear in certain communities. And so, in the nation Israel was living in a state of fear. I can imagine that the disciples, that John and Peter, they went back home because they were scared. They thought somebody was going to show up at the tomb and arrest them for being there with Jesus. But I didn't come to give you a sad story. Let me give you this, and I'm going to get out of the way. See, we can bounce back. We can bounce back. We can bounce back when we first, when we decide our losses don't define us. Wait, Big Sean say, I decided. You got to make a conscious decision that you are not going to allow your losses to define you. But let me say that again. You got to make a conscious decision that my losses will not define. Wait. See, look, if you hadn't lost yet, it's because you ain't played. It's impossible to be in the game and not lose. You have that, and some of your greatest successes are going to come from your biggest failures. And some of your losses are going to be the things that catapult you into where God could have you to be. Don't let your losses define you. We need to decide we will live or die for God regardless of whether I'm here or down here. You got to decide that my losses will not define me. They are set. You know what I say? I say, wherever I lose, all it is God setting you up for a victory. That's all it is God setting you up for a victory. Every time you lose, God is positioning you, putting you closer to where God would have you to be. We got to decide our losses don't define us. But then we got to make moves. We got to move toward God. I like that song about Big Sean. I got to move. You gotta have to move. You gotta keep moving. You can't keep still. You gotta keep moving. See, the thing is, in that verse 17, Jesus, he tells Mary, I gotta keep moving. Wait, I ain't got time to be hugging right now. I got to move on. I got to go meet up with my father. See, the thing is, when life hits us hard, we want to stay still. We want to sit and do nothing. But the only way you're going to rebound is you keep moving. If you when you hurt yourself, when I had my scooter accident, I like to dress it up and say my motorcycle accident, but my scooter accident, I ain't gonna lie, church. One of the first things the doctor told me, they said, as soon as you can, you need to get up and move. So physical therapy, when I had my breakdancing accident, I had a breakdance, and I told her, girl, I was getting down. The doctor told me, she said, as soon as I take the soft cast off, you gotta keep moving this arm, or it's just gonna stay stuck.
Yeah.
Well, okay. So, what does that tell you? In your situation, if you just sit there, you gonna stay stuck. You gonna stay tight. You not gonna be able to move. But in the midst of your hurt and your pain, you got to keep moving. You got to move. Yeah. Yeah. Baby, you got to decide that your losses don't define you. You got to keep on moving toward God's purpose in your life. Yeah. But then, you got to make some sacrifices.
Come on.
One of my favorite songs by Big Sean is Sacrifice. I don't know if you've ever heard it, but Big Sean talks about, he sacrifices. He talks about you got to make some sacrifices. You got to make some sacrifices. And wait, go to chapter 19. That was a sacrifice. But see, you want to blow up.
Come on.
But you don't want to sacrifice. You want to be a lawyer, but you don't want to go to law school. You don't want them long hours of staying up studying. You want to run a department, but you want to be the first one to leave. You want to lead a song, but you want to read the lyrics off the song. Help me. You want to play in an orchestra, but the only time you pick up your instrument. Okay. We don't want to sacrifice and to move anywhere in life. There has to be some sacrifice. And the thing is, the sacrifice hurts. It hurts financially, it hurts emotionally, but it hurts. It hurts. You look at people who have been successful, they've made sacrifices. Look at that story. Tyler Perry lived in his car. Kathy Hughes lived in the car. They made sacrifices because they knew where God was calling them to. You got to make some sacrifices. And finally, the last thing in that verse 18. When we realize this is bigger than me.
Well. Wait.
See, most of the stuff that we do is all about us. We think, it's all about me. But when you stop, when you really say, you know what? This is bigger than me.
All right.
I like what Big Sean says. He said, I'm standing in a room and they're waiting on my words. And I realize, this is bigger than me. We think it's all about us. But see, for Jesus, it was easier to stay in the tomb. It was easier to go to the cross. But Jesus had to realize, this is bigger than me. All of the disciples, when they realized he had risen, they had to understand that this is bigger. This is bigger than me. Regardless whether I live or I die, this is bigger than me.
Yeah.
So you need to find your purpose and understand that if it's about you, honestly, it ain't about God. Yeah, I said, if it's all about you, it ain't about God. It's about you. You worship yourself. But when you realize this is bigger than me, when you can come to a meeting and stuff don't go your way, and things don't pan out at church the way you want them to, and you can say, you know what? This is bigger than me. When the marriage is having some issues, and you just want to get your way, you say, oh, this is bigger than me. When you don't want to get up and go to work because you're tired and you mad and your coworkers get on your nerve, But you still go anyway. You say, this is bigger than me. Amen. I got my own defense. When you decide that everything that your life is more than just who you are.
Amen.
See, the thing is, I tagged this text, Bounce Back, because I like the lyrics of it. I like it, well, particularly the first part of the hook. It says, last night I took a pill.
Come on.
But now I bounce back. Wait. So if you don't know what an L is, he said last night I took a loss, but tonight I bounce back. Okay, so I can imagine Jesus saying, 2 days ago I took a L. But today I bounce back. I can hear Jesus saying, wait. They thought they had me 2 days ago. So, in the midst of all of this, whenever you lose, you need to say, I took an L tonight, but tomorrow, I'm going to bounce back. Tomorrow,